let's begin our tour of LINQ to SQL by walking through the four basic things you do with any database: select, insert, update, and delete. But instead of punching through to SQL statements, we're going to do it all natively from C Sharp. I'm Scott Stanfield with Vertigo Software, and this is the first video of a multi-part series on LINQ to SQL. Now, I've got a simple Visual Studio 2008 project here with two files already built. The first one is the LINQ to SQL class. It's an ORM mapping of the product and category tables from the Northwind database that I have right here. That's running on SQL Server 2005. And it's mapped to this file, which generates some code behind. Now, the second video, I'll go into details about how this works, but for now, just understand that there's some C# source code right here that we're going to be using through LINQ to help manipulate the database. The other file, I'll close this now, the other file is this default.aspx page. And it's got four buttons, and a grid view. So we'll start just first by writing a simple select statement. Now, we need to use that Northwind data context, which is from that file that I showed you just a second ago. Okay, now we have an instance of that. Now, to do a query against the system, we need to first have a variable to store the return value. So we'll do that through this thing called an implicitly typed local variable. And fancy word for var, but we'll call it products. And we're going to get our data from DB. We'll just query the products table. And I want to find everything where the category ID, notice that's a column from the products table, equals 1, or let's say 2, it doesn't matter. And we'll select everything from that statement. Now we'll take that grid view and bind its data source to the return value there. Notice I don't have to specify the type. The implicit typing as a feature in C# 3.0 figures that out for us. Finally, let's do the data bind and see what this looks like. And there we go. It's our simple select statement and works pretty well. So let's go back and make a few modifications. Now, because this is just like SQL, I can do things like, let's say instead of using that 2, let's go into the category table and pull back the category name and make this a little bit better, more readable, and find all the ones, all the products that are part of the beverages category. Now, the reason it knew how to, that LINQ knew how to do and go through that, is that I had the category, it knows the category is related to the products table through the foreign key. So I was able to go all the way down in there and pull the beverages back. Behind the scenes, it's doing a join between the products and categories table for us. And let's pull back the ones where, let's change the order by, I don't know, we'll order by the product ID in descending order. And instead of selecting everything, let's just pull back a few things like the product ID, the product name, the category name, and finally the price. Now, this last line of code is an example of something called shaping. So we're shaping this query to only return, it looks like, what, 4 columns. Again, the return value all goes into products. And so we don't have to specify any more information about that because the type of products is inferred from this anonymous type that's being generated from the LINQ statement. So let's run it again. Great. This is a little bit more readable. We have just the products that are of type category beverages. And the reason I did it in reverse order is because now I want to insert a new product and it should show up at the top. So let's write the code for that. Insert. In fact, let me just go back. I'll add all the placeholders here for insert, update, and delete. Okay, for insert, in fact, for all 4 of these, tell you what, let's do a couple things. I'm going to take this select statement, if I can just get that code, and refactor that into a new method called show products, and I'll call that not only when you click select, but also when the page is loaded. Now, when we do our insert, update, delete at the end of the statement, I'll refresh and show you what the product pages look like. Okay, so insert, I'll need this line as well. So now if we want to insert a new product, well, we need a new product. So let's create a new one. Product P1 equals new product. Now I can use this nifty new feature here called an object initializer that allows me to, with the typical properties, the gets and sets, I can put it all in one line to really clean this up. So let's put this in category ID 1 and set the product name equal to Scott's Apple Juice, and set the unit price equal to $4.23. That's pretty good. Now we'll go to the products table, the products collection that lives inside of our Northwind data context, and I'll insert that. Now notice the name of the method is called insert on submit. That means it's not going to be added to the database until I call submit. So right now nothing's happened until I do submit changes. And then finally, let's show the products. Tighten this up here. It looks like I have a mistake. Oops. Oh yeah. This is a decimal type, so I need to put an M as a signifier there. Okay, here's the product table, all the beverages, and if I insert a new one, there's Scott's Apple Juice at the top. Great, so far so good. So now let's update that. We'll change the price to something else. You can start to see a pattern here. We need the database context. Go into our update statement. Okay, now let's pull back the product that represents the one I just added. In this case, I'll go directly to the products collection and find the first one that matches this predicate where, let's see, the product name starts with Scott's. And then once we have it, we'll set the unit price equal, let's just increment it by $2.25. And we'll update the database context, update or submit changes. And finally, we'll show the products table again. So there's our apple juice for $4.23. If I hit update, I can keep hitting it. You can see the price is growing. Okay, finally, let's hook up delete. Let's take the database context, and we might as well find the same, oh geez, I guess we just pull back the same product. And we simply call, let's see, products.delete on submit, and we'll submit the changes again and show the products table. So you can see that we're similar to the update statement. We need to basically find the same product. And there's a couple ways we can find the first one that matches this query like we did above. Or let's try something else. Let's find the, instead of the first, we'll select the single, and this should find the one and only product that starts with the product name. Now, if this returns more than one, then it'll throw an exception. In this case, normally the database would probably be designed where the product name has an alternative key, because you'd expect that you'd only sell products in Northwinds where the product name is unique, but I'm pretty sure in this case Scott's is the only one that's in there. So let's try this. So let's update it again just to make sure Scott's Apple Juice is in there. Now I choose delete and it's gone. So good, we've gone through all four of the primary pieces of LINQ. Now there's a lot more obviously behind this, and in the next video I'll go into more detail on how we created the ORM mapping file, and we'll go a bit further also in the next video series about what else you can do with the select, insert, update, and deletes.